Hello everybody, welcome to the webinar today. We're going to talk about JM Bayes. And we have Demetris here. He's the package author and maintainer. So just going to cover some quick logistics things before we start the webinar today. So all of you have a GoToWebinar control panel. And if you click this orange button that has an arrow on it, it will maximize and minimize your control panel. So you can click it two or three times and it'll just toggle between a maximized state and a minimized state back to a maximized state. And then you'll see options. You'll see an audio menu here. Most people are going to attend in mic and speakers mode. If you're in the United States, you can attend via telephone, but keep in mind this may cost you some money depending on your long distance phone plan. And be sure to close other applications you might have open that could take bandwidth. Things like Skype, LinkedIn, Facebook, Twitter, Gmail, etc. And then you can make my screen larger by grabbing a corner of the GoToWebinar screen and just dragging it. It'll make my desktop larger. If you have headphones, go ahead and plug them in. You don't really need headphones today, but they're good to have. It's easier to hear the voice of the speaker. Things like iPod earbuds work great, or if you have a headset, like a USB or analog headset, that'll work fine as well. So there's a question and answer pane here, as you can see shown in red. And this question and answer pane allows you to send questions. We're going to do a question and answer period at the very end of the webinar where you can ask the speaker questions. So you can just send them during the webinar, type them into the pane, and then click the send button. And then you'll be able to send your questions in. So let me just talk about myself very quickly. My name is Ray DiGiacomo Jr. I'm president of the Orange County R User Group. So this webinar is being brought to you by the Orange County R User Group. I'm also a healthcare predictive analytics consultant. And if you'd like to learn more about Orange County R, you can learn about us on LinkedIn groups. So that's just a little bit about myself. And the video right now is, we're recording right now, and you'll get an email today with a URL to the recording of this webinar. Should be up on the internet within the next 7 days, so please give us about 7 days to upload the video. In terms of upcoming R webinars that are hosted by the Orange County R User Group, so on May 20th, we're going to do a webinar on RCPP with the package author and maintainer. And then on May 21st, we're going to do a webinar on R Selenium with the package author and maintainer. And then on June 24th, we're going to do a webinar on rough sets with the package author and maintainer. And you can register for these at liondatasystems.com/events. That's liondatasystems.com/events. Okay, so now what I'm going to do is change presenter to Demetris. And Demetris, go ahead and show your screen when you're ready.
Okay, so everybody
can see your screen. Yeah, I can see your screen. Go ahead and introduce yourself, and you have the floor.
Okay, so hello, everyone. My name is Dimitris Rizopoulos, and I come from the Department of Biostatistics of the Erasmus Medical Center in the Netherlands. So first of all, let me thank Ray for proposing to do this webinar and introduce a recent package that I have written called JM Bayes, where this is used to fit a special and we could say new class of statistical models, which are known as join models. So first, let me say that this class of models have been around for a lot of years now, about 10 to 15 years. There has been a lot of research in these models. And I have also written recently a book on how you can fit them with R, which you can find in CRC Press. And mainly, these models have been used in biostatistics applications, where is also my background. But nowadays, they have been starting using these models also in many different frameworks, like also in econometrics, also in animal studies, or even in civil engineering. So let me go through the goals of this talk for today. So first of all, because as I said, this is a relatively new type of models. So at first, I'm going to briefly introduce them. So what is the basic idea, in which settings they are applied. Then I would like to spend a few slides and speak about a new kind of application these models have, and this is to obtain predictions that have very nice applicability in personalized medicine. And of course, I'm going to talk about of how we can fit these models and how we can also obtain these predictions. And as you see here, I actually mentioned two packages because I have written two packages to fit these models. So package JM fits the models under standard maximum likelihood. And the one that I'm primarily going to focus for today is the JM Bayes that fits the same kind of models but using a Bayesian approach with MCMC. But in principle, both packages can be used to fit the same kind of models. Okay, so first let me say a few words of when, in which settings, as I said, we apply these models. And in general, we apply them in follow-up data, follow-up studies, where the defining characteristic of such type of studies is that we have one type of outcome that we measure in time from our sample units. So as I said, because I also come from a department of biostatistics, in my case, the sample units are typically patients, in which these patients we measure biomarkers, could be, let's say, blood pressure, cholesterol levels, and so on. But as I also just mentioned, we could also apply the same kind of, we have the same type of data and same type of problems in many different settings. So as in animal studies where we could be interested in weight of animals, or recently I had also some contacts from people from civil engineering where they have been interested in doing studies in having indices measuring the structural integrity of buildings. Now, a nice feature of such type of data, such type of follow-up studies is that they allow us to investigate two different things. So the one type of effect that we can study and measure with this data is called the so-called cross-sectional effect, which means that I would be interested in at specific time points, let's say at the middle of the study or at the end of the study. Are there differences between males and females at the end of the studies? Or are there differences for the structural integrity between one type of buildings and another type of buildings, and so on? But also, and is also relevant to what I would like to speak today, this type of studies, they also offer us the opportunity to study the so-called longitudinal effect, which means that how the outcome that we are interested in, how does it change in time? And if we study these changes in time, if these changes in time are informative for other things. And what other things this may be, it is typically that in this type of data, in this type of studies, that we are not only have one type of outcome, as I just mentioned, the one that we measure in time, but we also have different types of events that may occur in our sample units. So again, in the biostatistics examples where we have patients, patients may die, patients may require reoperations, patients may develop a disease. Or like in the civil engineering example, a building may be inhabitable after a few years. So now, to bring it together, what is the type of questions that I am interested in and why we have developed this type of models is if we would like to associate the two outcomes that I have just mentioned. So if I could see if the longitudinal outcome is predictive for the event outcome. So if I'm going to study how the blood pressure of a patient evolves in time, is this going to give me some information of when this patient is going to develop a disease or if when this patient is going to die, and so on. So the idea then is to see how these questions can be answered, and just to introduce it and make all the details and features behind this type of questions more clear, let me now introduce a small example that I'm going to use in my slides to illustrate all these things. So this is actually comes from a quite old study that has been done in Mayo Clinic in the States. And this actually is a very well-known data set that you can also find in the survival package in R. And this is called the Primary Biliary Cirrhosis Dataset, or PBC dataset, where this concerns patients that have a chronic, fatal, but rare liver disease. As I said, that has been a quite old randomized clinical trial, where half of the people have been randomized to an active treatment and the remaining to placebo. And during now the follow-up of the study, as I mentioned, there have been several type of biomarkers recorded for these patients. Just for simplicity, I'm going to focus just on one of them, the bilirubin, which is considered the more relevant for patients having this specific liver disease. So during follow-up, we have recorded the bilirubin levels at different time points for different patients. And as I said, unfortunately, this is a fatal disease, so the patients die at the end. But the idea is to see that how can I associate the two outcomes. So first of all, is bilirubin associated with the risk for dying? And second of all, if I'm going to study how the bilirubin evolves in time for a particular patient, would that be able to predict when this patient is going to die? And as you can imagine, this is a very relevant question, and also especially nowadays, because in medicine in general, we have for quite some years now a turn towards personalized medicine techniques, where we would be interested to take some decisions for a particular patient. So we really need to be able to predict when a particular patient is going to die, how soon is going to die, and then adapt the treatment that we are going to give to this patient specifically to him, and maybe choose some other treatment for patients that are going to die later on. Okay, so now the next couple of slides are some descriptive plots to show you how the data look like. So let me say again that we have the two outcomes. The first one that you can see here is again the longitudinal outcome, the biomarker, the serum bilirubin, where as you can read from the y-axis, I have put it in the log scale because this is a skewed, has a skewed distribution. So we clearly see here separately for placebo and active treatment patients a lot of variability in the profiles of the patients. And as I said again, the purpose is to see if I study these profiles, if I will be able to predict the risk for death. And these are the Kaplan-Meier estimates for the survival outcome, where in this particular study it was shown that actually the difference between the two treatment groups, so placebo and the active treatment these patients took, was non-significant. So treatment didn't do anything, but as I said here, we're going to focus not on treatment but on the predictive value of the serum bilirubin. So as I have already motivated to answer this type of questions, we have these joint models for longitudinal and survival or time to event data in general. And to simply explain how this work, and also as probably you can guess from the name, the intuitive idea behind them is that we are going to combine two types of models. So we're going to use one model to describe how the biomarker, the longitudinal outcome, evolves in time. And then estimating these evolutions for each one of our patients, we're going to plug them in a Cox model, where this is a typical model that we use to study the risk of the risk for a specific disease, or the risk for death in this case. So now I said it in words, but let me show it also in a simple figure. So again, in essence, this is what is a joint model. In the top panel, we have the hazard process, so what is the risk of dying at any particular time point T that we have in the x-axis. And in the bottom panel, we have the longitudinal outcome. Now, what we see here, the asterisks that you see here are the observed data, so are the observed values of the biomarker. Now, what these models are going to do, they are going to build the green line that you see here. So for each one of the patients, and based on the data of the patients, they're going to estimate what is the profile of this patient at any particular time point. So the one that is denoted here by the vertical dashed line, so at any particular time point, we're going to say that the risk at this particular time point is associated with the profile of the longitudinal biomarker at the same time point. Now, also in this plot, you see in the background, I also have a blue line, which is a step function. And the reason why I have that is to illustrate and explain why in this particular setting we should not use the Cox model alone. So as probably many of you know, the Cox model is a typical model that we use for survival data. But if we're going to apply this model in this particular setting, then the assumption that we make is the step blue function that you see here. So we assume that from one visit to the next, so the level of the biomarker was exactly constant, and at the time point the patient came to the hospital to give us the blood sample, we have a sudden jump of the biomarker. So I hope that you can agree with me that this is not reasonable to assume for a biomarker that remains constant and then we have a sudden jump the day that the patient comes to the study center. It's much more logical to build this underlying profile of the biomarker. And this is what we do with these joint models. So let me use very few mathematics now just to illustrate how these models work. But they're not going to be a key for what comes next, just for completeness to introduce how these models are defined. So I'm going to use TI star to denote the event time, the true event time of the patients. But usually what we have available is TI and delta I, so the observed event time and the event indicator, because for some of the patients we didn't observe them die during follow-up, so they're censored. And by YI, I have the vectors, so I have the responses of each one of my patients, so the serum bilirubin measurements. So I'm going to introduce the model in simple three steps. So in the first step, I'm going to introduce the basic Cox model, where this actually describes, if I go back, this is the top panel, so describes the red line. So the red line is the hazard function, is the risk function that is described by this equation. So this says that the hazard of any patient I at time point T is some baseline hazard times the exponent of baseline covariance, so it could depend on the age of the patients, the gender of the patients, and so on. But the important piece of the model is this one that we see here, where this term, the MIT, is the biomarker. So is the level of the biomarker at time point T. So is the green line that you see here. Okay, so this is our risk model, but the problem in this model is, of course, that what I have observed are just the asterisks. So I don't have the green line. So to estimate the green line, I go to step two, and I postulate a second model, which is called a mixed effects model, which says that the observed level of the biomarker is the underlying level of the biomarker plus an error term. So this, in essence, describes, as I just mentioned, the green line. So the green line that we see here is described by this model. And the important thing in this type of models, just as a technical detail to mention, is that we need to use these random effects terms, because are these terms that allow each one of the patients to have a completely different evolution in time. So some patients could have a constant bilirubin profile in time, other patients could have an increasing, other patients could have a decreasing profile in time, and so on. And at step three, I bring the two models together and I estimate the whole joint model. So that was a brief definition and introduction to the joint modeling framework. And let me now go a little bit forward and say how we can fit these models. So as I already mentioned, I have written two packages to fit these models, the JM and the JM base, that the first one fits under standard maximum likelihood, whereas the second one is using Bayes and fits the model using a Markov chain Monte Carlo algorithms. So to illustrate a little bit, so first I'm going to do the analysis and then I'm going to show you the syntax of how it works. So I'm going to do it for the PBC dataset, where I have defined one particular mixed model to describe the evolution of serum bilirubin in time, and a second model to describe the hazard, so the risk of dying. So I say in the biomarker model that there is a time effect, so bilirubin changes in time, and also the how bilirubin changes in time could also be affected by treatment. And for the risk model, for the time from the time to death, I say that also this could depend on treatment, and also depends on serum bilirubin, so the biomarker. Now, this is the output, a piece of the output that we take. And in particular, we're interested here in the association parameter, where this association parameter, if I scroll back to the definition of the model, is this parameter alpha that you see here, where this parameter alpha, if it is statistically significant, it means that the biomarker, the serum bilirubin that I have recorded, is highly associated with the risk for dying. And this is what we obtain indeed from this result, that indeed serum bilirubin is very highly associated. And in particular, for every 0.1 unit increase in the log serum bilirubin, I see that I have a 15% increase in the risk for dying. So a thing that I didn't mention, that actually an increase in level of this biomarker is bad for the patient. So each time bilirubin is higher, the risk of dying increases with this particular confidence interval that you see here. Okay, now let me show you how this can be fitted with my packages. And as I have already explained, in order to fit this type of models, what we actually need to do is to define two sets of models. So we need to define one model for the longitudinal outcome for the serum bilirubin, which is I have repeated measurements for each of one of my subjects, and also specify a Cox model, and also specify how exactly the two are connected. Now, if I want to translate all this in R, what it means that I have to deal with three R formulas at the same time, and possibly with different data frames containing the variables of the variables that I want to include in these models. Which, if any of you have tried to program with R formulas and environments and things like that, things can become messy. So to overcome this problem and even make it easier for the user, but also for myself, the package developer, what I have decided to do is to ask for the user to actually first fit the two models separately using other standard packages that we have in R. So to fit separately a mixed model that describes how serum bilirubin changes in time, fit a Cox model that describes which baseline covariates are affecting the time to death, and then I put these two models in my function that I have in my package to fit the join model. So let me make it a little bit more specific. Now, to fit mixed models in R, we have a variety of packages available, but the two most important ones are the NLME package and the LME4 package. Now, both of them can fit linear mixed effects models, are the models that I'm currently using in my packages, so for continuous outcomes, but they have a little bit of a different syntax. So the LME4 is a newer package and it's a faster package. They can also fit generalized mixed models for categorical outcomes, but the NLME has more capabilities for random effect structures and structures for the error terms. And now I had, when I was writing my package, I had to choose for one of those, And at the time that I have been writing my package, LME4 was not at the most stable version yet. And for this reason, I decided to build my package around the NLME package. Where in this package, and in order to fit a mixed model, we have the basic function called LME for linear mixed effects, where we need three basic arguments. So a fixed argument that describes what are the fixed effects in the model, so the response vectors, here in this case serum bilirubin, the fixed effect structure. We have an argument random describing the random effect structure, so how the evolution for each one of the patients changes in time, and a data frame that contains the variables in these formulas. Just to mention, because an important detail, that if you would like to use this function to fit mixed models, or in general for fitting mixed models, we need to have the data in the so-called long format, so where we have multiple rows for the same subject, so as the example that you see here. So having the data in this format, the model that I have fitted to do the analysis that I have already presented to you is this one that you see here. So this is the standard call to the LME function. So this is the fixed argument. So this is the response vector where I put here my time variable. So this is year, and I put year interaction with treatment. PBC2 is the data frame that contains a variable. And the random argument says which are the random effects. So here I assume that I have an intercept by default and a different slope per patient. Okay, so that was the first model. So the second model is the Cox model. And the basic function and basic package that we have in R for fitting Cox models or survival analysis in general is the survival package, which is a recommended package. Probably many of you have already used it before. And one key function that we have there is the SERV function that we use it to denote the survival information that we have available. So in this function, we have to put two variables. So the time variable, which are the observed event time, and the status variable, which is the event indicator. So it should be one if that was a true event, so if I saw the patient die, and zero if the patient was right sensor. So that was the last time point when the patient left the study. So this is the basic syntax of this function. And this function is used inside the Cox PH function that is used to fit the Cox model. So you see in the formula that I have here in the Cox PH, I need to put on the left-hand side this SERV function to denote the survival information. And as baseline covariates, I have put treatment, the gender of the patients, and the age of the patients. So again, that was a brief review of these two basic R packages in R. But now, if you would like to fit the join models that I have already introduced to you, what you need to do is, as I mentioned, to first separately fit the two models. So first I fit the model, the linear mixed model for serum bilirubin. I fit the Cox model for the time to death. And then I put it inside the join model function. So in the JM package that fits under maximum likelihood, the function is called join model. Whereas in the JM base package, the function is called join model base. So to make it easy, you just have to add the base acronym here. And as I mentioned, the basic syntax of this function is that you just copy and paste the objects that you have already fitted. So this is the mixed model object, this is the Cox model object, and I'm going also to explain in a bit what is that. And this will gonna fit the join model, and with the summary function we get the output that I have already shown you with the results of how strongly associated is the serum bilirubin with the risk for dying. Now a few details behind my function and things you need to keep in mind. So as I have already mentioned, when in order to fit the mixed model, we need the data in the so-called long format, where I have multiple rows per patient. Whereas if I'm going to fit the Cox model, I just need the standard version of a data set where I have a single row per patient. Now, what I assume in my function, and I assume it because unfortunately there is no direct way to check it by the two separate object fits, is that the ordering of the subjects is the same. So the first set of rows in the long format corresponds to the first row in the data frame that you used in the Cox model. And the second set of rows in the log format corresponds to the second patient, so to the second row in the data set that you used in the Cox PH, and so on. So this is one thing that you have to keep in mind. A second one, and this one you're going to be informed about it if you forget it, is that in your call to the Cox PH function, you need also to add this argument x equal true. So if you forget it, you're going to receive an error message that said that you forgot to do it, and so go and fit the Cox model again. And the reason for this is in order in this Cox model to have this information. So which baseline covariates you included in the model. And the last thing that you need to specify is the time var argument in my function, in the join model base function, where this is simply to say what in the mixed model, which is specifically the variable that denotes time. So when you're going to build your mixed effects model here, you can include a bunch of covariates, but one of these covariates should be time, because this model should describe how the biomarker or the longitudinal outcome in general, how it changes in time. So does it change in a linear fashion, is a nonlinear function, and so on. So I need to know what specifically is the time variable in the mixed model for the internal computations that are required to fit these joint models. So now, as I said, I have the two packages, the JM, the JM base. Now the JM base is the newer version that fits using MCMC. And it's, in some respects, I have made it over even more flexible than the JM that I have. So the JM that fits under maximum likelihood can only fit joint models for continuous longitudinal outcomes, so for continuous biomarkers. In the case of the JM base, you can also fit categorical biomarkers. And also, it allows for general transformation functions. And by that, I mean that you can, for instance, include interaction effects of bilirubin with treatment or with the age of the patients or with the gender of the patients, which was not directly available in the JM package. So as any package authors of you know, if each time you write a new package, you gain from experience that from previous packages that you have written how you can make it better. So this is what's happened also in this case. And just to mention here for completeness that I have written methods for many standard generic functions that we have in R. So many functions that probably you know from other models that you use to fit other types of regression models in R, like the summary, ANOVA, VKOV, coefficient function, the fixed effects runner, fitted values, residuals, plot, all this you can also use for joint models that you have fitted with my package. And also, if you happen to be a LaTeX user, then I have also written a method for the XTable function from the XTable package, which if you just fit it, the fitted joint model, it can produce you the code for a LaTeX table that you can include in your LaTeX document, so you don't have to copy-paste the results. Okay, so now as a final piece of illustration, I would like to close and mention some things about this new application of this type of models in personalized medicine, as I have already mentioned from the beginning. And as I said, these models present us with a very nice tool for producing predictions for individual patients. And to really show you what I mean by that, I'm going to do it for two patients from the PBC dataset, namely patient 2 and 25, who has given us 9 and 12 measurements of serum bilirubin respectively. And these are the longitudinal trajectories of the two patients. So let me remind you again that an increasing profile of serum bilirubin, as we see here for patient 2, actually implies a worsening of the condition of the patient. So would expect that patient 2 has much lower survival probability, so he is going to die much sooner than patient 25, who has a stable profile of serum bilirubin. Now, as you see here also, I use the adjective dynamic predictions, and what I mean by the dynamic, and here is where it comes the connection with personalized medicine, the dynamic comes from the fact that here I have collected repeated measurements. So I have several measurements for each one of my patients. And if this happens in real clinical practice, we could think that what the physician would like to obtain and have available in order to make the most optimal decision is to have a prediction for the risk of the patient each time I have a new measurement for the patient. So if we think about it here, so this is the first measurement of patient 2. So the physician would like to have a prediction based on this, but when the patient comes again and gives us the second measurement, then the physician would like to obtain an update of the prediction and so on. So each time we have a new measurement of the biomarker, I have more understanding of what is going on with this patient, and therefore I would like my prediction to take into account this information and update accordingly. So as I said, joint models provide us with this capability in doing that, so we can use these models to have these dynamically updated individualized predictions. And in general, this is the basic problem that we're interested in. So by this calligraphic Y that you see here, I denote for any particular patient all the measurements that I have for this patient up to any time point T. So let's say if I take time point T 3 years, I take all the measurements that I have collected for this patient for the first 3 years. And then, using my joint model, what I would like to do is to estimate this conditional probability. So why I say conditional probability? Because for this patient, I have two pieces of information. So the first piece of information that I have is the measurements, but I also have the piece of information that this patient was alive up to this time point. So he didn't have the event yet. So given that he was alive and given all the measurements that I have for this patient, what is the probability that he's going to survive at a later time point U, where U is greater than T? So given that he has survived up to year 3, what is the probability that he's going to survive up to year 5, and so on? So I'm not going to show you any details of how this can be done. So all the technicalities can be found in a paper I have written where you can find in Biometrics. But let me go and illustrate of what is the outcome of these predictions. And I'm going to use exactly the same joint model that we have seen before, so the one that I have fitted, and I illustrate you where in this model I found that I have a statistical significant association between the serum bilirubin and the risk for dying. And using the same model, I would like now to use it for obtaining predictions. And I'm going to do it for the two patients that we have already seen, for patient 2 and patient 25. Just let me mention here for completeness, and in order to be more fair, what I have actually done is that I have fitted the model excluding these two patients. So I have fitted the model in the remaining patients, and I'm going to treat these two patients as new patients from the same population. So these are patients which I have not used in fitting the model and are new patients that the physician is going to see in his office and for whom we would like to obtain predictions. So to illustrate you also the dynamic nature and the dynamic update of the predictions, what I'm going to do, as you see in this figure here, I'm going each time to cut at the vertical dashed lines that I denote here. So I'm going each time to use the values of the biomarker before this time point to obtain a prediction, and then I'm going to go to the next time point and so on. So that will be just to illustrate you of how these predictions dynamically are updated in time. So these are the results. So this is a simple plot with these predictions. So let me explain what actually are we seeing here. So as you can read on the left hand side, I have patient 2. On the right hand side, I have patient 25. And just let me mention that this plot has two axes. So we have vertical axes. Sorry. So we have one vertical axis on the left side, where in this left side I read the level of serum bilirubin of the biomarker, and on the right side axis I read the corresponding survival probability. So what is the probability that this patient is going to survive more than the time, the years that are denoted on the x-axis. So these are the predictions that I obtain using only the first single measurements of the patient, so only the baseline measurements. So these are the corresponding survival probabilities with a corresponding confidence interval, where you can see that, as we expect, that as I want to predict further in time, I have more uncertainty for the predictions, where are close to the last value that I have for the biomarker, I am much more certain for the risk that I obtain. So this is now when I go to the first dashed line, where I have collected the two measurements for patient 2, and I have still one measurement for patient 25. And here is with the next time point, and here is where the difference comes. So we already see that for patient 2, the survival, so the probability that this patient is going to survive, is lower than for patient 25, and this is because of the level of serum bilirubin. So this patient has a higher level of serum bilirubin compared to the other patient. But really, we see a change between these two time points because I have a clear increase in the profile of bilirubin. So again, as I said, increase in profile of bilirubin clearly indicates a worsening of the condition of the patient, and as we see, this is directly translated to the corresponding survival probabilities, that indeed for these patients I have much lower probability that he is going to survive compared to patient 25, who has a stable profile and has very high probability of surviving. Now, how we can do that? So how can we obtain these predictions from the joint models that we have fit in a particular data set? So to do that, we have a function in both of my packages. So is that the function is exactly the same. So either you fit with maximum likelihood, or you're going to fit it with MCMC. The function is called SurfitJM, where what you need just to give in this function is you just need to give the fitted joint model, so the model that you have fitted based on the data that you already have. And then we have a second argument, the data argument, where here you just have to give the data frame of the data of the new patient, so the patient for whom you would like to do the predictions. And in that particular case, as I said, I use the patient, for example, here I use patient 2. So this is the data frame that has the repeated measurements for patient 2. So in this call, we are going to directly obtain the survival probabilities. And if you use the plot function, and in particular, if you say include y equals true, so it means include also the y, where y is the longitudinal outcome, then you're going to obtain this type of plot, which I find it a very informative plot because it conveys both pieces of information that we have in this data. So what is the estimated longitudinal profile for the subject, and how is this translated to survival probabilities? Now, as I said, I have been using these models a lot also for my own research, but also for the collaborations that I have in my department with several other departments in my university, in the medical center where I work. And one feature and one question that I have had from my medical colleagues have been how can we easily translate all this nice modeling framework that produces these nice predictions that can bring a difference in applying medicine, how can we really translate it in the office of the doctor? Where, of course, the office of the doctor would not like to run any R code and run this particular command. So to really help in that, what I have also done is I have written a web interface for producing these dynamic predictions using the Syni package, which is a package probably that many of you have heard of, and it's a very nice package that we can use to build web interfaces of our code. So I have this code available already, so if you go and download my package from CRUN, and if you go to the demo folder, I have the required scripts that you need to run the Syni web interface, and you can run it with this simple command that you see here. So the run app, we run the application, and here this is where the application is saved in your computer, assuming that you have installed my package in the default library. Otherwise, you will need to adapt this this file path. So, as a final illustration, I would like to show you how this works. So here I have an OpenR, and by running the Syni app, now what this will do, as you see, it fire apps an Internet Explorer or a Mozilla Firefox or what is your web browser window, what is your default web browser window. And how it works in two steps. So the first step is that the user, the physician, will first need to load the R workspace that contains the fitted join module. So it contains the join module in which he has already fitted in an existing database for the specific type of disease and specific type of patients. Now, what the web interface is doing by this fitted join model, it sees that it needs this specific type of variables. So in this particular example, this is not the PBC dataset. This is another example of a dataset that I have been recently working on. So these are for patients that underwent a valve transplantation in the aortic position. And the biomarker in this case is the aortic gradient. We also had different types of operation. So the time is at which time points this biomarker has been recorded. And also we have included in the model that we used this baseline covariate. So the age of the patients, gender, and BMI. And as you see here, the web interface from the workspace, it reads which variables it needs and what these variables should be. So for instance, the aortic gradient is an integer, it's a numeric variable, so it's a continuous variable. Whereas the type of operation should be a factor, where the levels should be SI and RR. So that have been the acronyms of the two types of operations these patients underwent. Now, the second option here is to load the data of a particular patient. So I'm going to load the data now for patient 81 from this data set. And as you see here, so this patient had six time points that have been the aortic gradient measurements. So he did this type of operation that the aortic gradient measurements have been recorded at these time points, the age, the gender, and the BMI. And what you obtain here, so at the other tab, so the data tab is the data of the subject that you, of the patient that we just imported. So these are the corresponding survival probabilities, and this is the same figure that we have already seen. But what I have also implemented is with this play button that you can see here, if you click on that, you will see the dynamic predictions changing in time. So I hope you can also see this in your screen. So this shows also to the physician, but also to the patient herself, of how exactly has been her profile of aortic gradient and how this profile is translated to survival probabilities. And just to illustrate, you can also change the scale of, instead of survival probabilities, you can also transform it to incidence. So this is cumulative incidence of an event. And on top of that, we could also do a plot that is also often used in this type of cases to denote, to translate the risk to a patient. And the figure that is typically used is to say to a patient that, look, these are 100 patients that are exactly like you, that have shown exactly the same measurements like you. And from these 100 patients and until the last measurement that you have, we see that 29 of those will have the event, so they will require reoperation in this case, whereas the remaining will not. So this is a nice way to translate, and with this plot to show to also to the physician, but also to the patient herself, of what is really going on with her, and perhaps even the physician, also the patient herself, decide maybe to change lifestyle or to change treatment and so on to perhaps decrease this risk for reoperation. So that was actually it. Just for last thing, let me mention again that I have written a book of how you can, what is the theory and how you can fit these models in R. Just let me say, in connection to the webinar that I just presented here, this book only describes the JEM package that fits the models under maximum likelihood. Does not contain the JEM base. That will be for the second edition in a couple of years, when I'm going to add also a few more extra features. But as I said, a lot of the things are very similar, so a lot of the functionality that I have for JEM also applies to JEM base. So that was it, and thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you, Dimitris. That was a great presentation. So we have some questions coming in here, and the first question is from Rob. And Rob asks, can you expand a bit on why you removed JAGS, WinBugs, OpenBugs from version 0.5?
Yeah, the reason why I did that is a kind of a technical reason that when I program it with JAGS, OpenBugs, or WinBugs, the code has been slow, very slow, because in order to fit these models, you had to use the so-called zero streak. So this is a trick that you need to use in the WinBugs language of coding for defining non-standard distributions. And because you need to do that for this particular type of models, this has been making the codes to run in JAGS or WinBugs very, very slow. So I decided for efficiency reasons to rewrite the whole MCMC myself, and to have it so it runs now in a much faster way. So the same type of model could take about, in the same number of iterations, could take about 50 minutes to run with JAGS, and now it takes around 3 to 5 minutes with my self-written MCMC code.
Great, great. Here's one from Huan Zhu. If the repeated measure is a dichotomous variable, will JM Bayes still work?
Yes, so as I said, this is one lesson I learned from my previous package. So in the previous, I only had continuous data. You can only have continuous data. In the JM Bayes, you can also have a categorical longitudinal outcome. So I give actually the option to the user to define his own density function for the longitudinal outcome. So you can also fit categorical or Poisson, or you can fit sensor data, so where we have detection limit problems and so on. And actually, I have now almost ready a paper for JSS that I probably am going to submit to JSS for Journal Statistical Software, and probably I'm also going to upload it in ArcSieve, where all the functionality of how all these things can be done will be illustrated in this paper.
Great. So here's a question from Dee, and Dee asks, this was a very cool presentation, interesting, practical, and well explained. So Dee is interested in any type of workshops or training. Do you have any workshops or training courses you do over the internet, Dimitris?
No, I don't have something planned, but I have been invited to give short courses in conferences, and but this year is only in Europe. So for next year, so 2015, I will send a proposal for JSMs, Joint Statistical Meetings.
Sure.
So, but I don't have something like kind of an online course at the moment.
Okay. Here's one from Yukai, and Yukai asks, can we enter time-varying Cox models to JMBase?
Well, unfortunately not yet. So it's one thing that I would like to include. So you can't do that in the JM. So that fits under maximum likelihood. So you can include a time-dependent Cox model in JM, but not yet in JMBase. So it's one of the features that I would like to add.
Okay. And here's a question from Terry Lee. And Terry Lee asks, can JM or JMBase handle left sensor time to event data?
Unfortunately, the answer is no. So again, it's a feature that I would like to add in JMBase. So
sure.
Yeah, as probably some of you know, all these developments and new features also comes from my personal use, so where I use the package for, but also from questions that I have from users of the package and features that they would like to get implemented and see in this package. So up to now, I have had a couple of people asking for that, but have been not in the top of my to-do list, because have been other things with these dynamic predictions to do first, like assign the application. But this will also come in a later version.
Sure. Dimitris, could you talk a bit about the future of JMBase and maybe like a roadmap, for example?
Yeah, so as I said, the first basic thing that I would like to show that the next big extension of the JMBase will be to handle multiple longitudinal outcomes, because this is also a thing that I'm very interested in, and also with the collaborations that I have with my medical colleagues. So up to now, and all the things that I have presented is only for one longitudinal outcome, one biomarker, but in real life application of medical applications, typically, we may record several biomarkers for the patients, and the question is of how we can combine all these biomarkers, for example, to obtain predictions. So then, the next big update that I have not started working yet, because now I have finalized this version of JMBase and have been taking some time to write a paper to explain the current features of the package. But the next big update will be to handle multiple longitudinal biomarkers, and also as some people discussed, to implement some additional features like left censoring, or like to include time-dependent Cox model. But these are relatively minor additions compared to adding multiple biomarkers.
Sure. Well, great. So it looks like we are almost at the top of the hour now. So
okay, great.
We can start wrapping it up, and thank you again, Dimitris. It was a great presentation.
Yes. Thank you also for the invitation.
Yes, yes. And we're recording this webinar, and we'll upload it to the internet. So if any of your colleagues out there would like to view, you can download it. We'll send out the URL to you sometime within the next 1 to 2 hours, and then it should be up on the internet within the next 7 days. Or so. And the OCR user group has some upcoming webinars and around the RCPP package, the R Selenium package, and the Rough Sets package. So those are coming up, and you all should have gotten a chat message about those. I will send everybody in the audience one more chat message so you can have a chance to register for the upcoming Orange County R user group webinars. So, yes, we thank you, Dimitris, from the Orange County R user group. It was great. Thank everybody in the audience for coming. And Dimitris, any parting words for the audience?
No, just was great and nice to hear there has been all this interest in my package, and it certainly keeps me motivated to add to the next versions.
Sure, sure. Great. All right, then. So
have a nice day.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you, everybody, for coming. We're going to shut it down. Have a good morning, afternoon, or evening, wherever you are. And we'll see you next time.